Welcome to One People, One World. My name is Rabbi Yaakov Cohen. I'm here with a very special guest, Rabbi Alter Metzger Benzion. He's a scholar, professor, a Talmud Chacham, etc. Shalom, Rabbi Metzger. Shalom.
Shalom.
And Rabbi Metzger, please tell us about his scholar and about yourself and about some of your work.
My name is Rabbi Alter Benzion Metzger. I'm a professor of Jewish studies at Yeshiva University. I'm also very much a follower of the Lubavitcher movement. I have a number of books to my credit. Among them is a book called The Heroic Struggle, and that book is about the imprisonment of the previous Lubavitcher Rebbe and his liberation. And this has a lot to do with what Mr. Cohen is doing over here. In other words,
Rabbi Metzger,
yes.
You were the one that organized, that was the MC for the Sheva Mitzvahs conference in YU a few years ago.
Yes, a number of years ago, yes. But basically, you coordinated, you get the credit.
I was just
a front man.
Right. So Rabbi Metzger, tell us about the Sheva Mitzvahs, the project that we're trying to promote goodness and kindness to the world.
I think that basically you're entitled to a good deal of praise for the fantastic things that you're doing. Just within the past few days, it's almost impossible for a normal person not to be horrified by spontaneous acts of violence and a lack of concern for the well-being of others. The children being killed, adults being killed, people pushed from platforms, etc. And your message is obviously a very important one. In other words, over here you have One People, One World.
That, which is the name of the show. It's titled One People, One World Under Guard. And we promote, with the picture of the Rebbe, we obviously promote the importance of the Noahide Lords, the seven Lords.
Noahide Lords, yeah. basically what, instead
the
of...
The Rambam. And then.
One could look at the world as very fragmented, very diversified, and disunited. And on the other hand, what you're really saying is, when you say one people, it means that there's a collective mankind, and one world, a collective entity, and there's interpersonal responsibility, and we have to be concerned for others. If we hear about acts of violence, if we hear acts of, about dishonesty, then you will speak about Sheva Mitzvahs B'nei Noach, the Noahide law. One of the Noahide laws is dinim, meaning that society has to be structured, society has to have discipline. If a person is going to speed, he's going to harm other people, he may even affect other people's lives. And but what you're basically saying is that I'm not living with your, the message is not, I'm not living as a separate entity, but I have collective responsibility for all of mankind. And obviously there are two sides to the coin, that if we accept this responsibility, then it will have many benefits, many lives will be saved, many lives will be helped. But just now with Sandy, with the hurricane, very interesting, over here it had a devastating effect, it impoverished many people. And there could have been many people who would say, well, it's somebody else's problem, it's not mine. But all of a sudden, we see something very interesting. There was a spontaneous awakening of many people, a concern. And I think that no matter how callous a person would want to be, when we speak about the significance of a human being, a human being is Tzelem Elokim, the image of God. So it's the image of God that he is part of this collective identity. We are part of a collective identity of humanity, and that by our acts of kindness we can save lives, we can bring optimism, we can bring motivation, and on the other hand, the reverse of that, there can be pessimism, there can be a sense of despondency. So your message is a very important one, and because...
And it's very apropos that yesterday was Maimonides' Yahrzeit. Maimonides was one of the foremost frontier on promoting, as Rebbe explained, that Maimonides said that we Jewish people have an obligation as well as a responsibility to promote that there's an eye that sees, there's an ear that hears, there's a higher presence among us.
Maimonides was both a physician, and also a profound religious thinker. One of my friends told me a very interesting thing. Yeshiva University came to Maimonides, came to Einstein,
right.
And they said to Einstein they wanted to use his name for their medical school. And Einstein's response was, Why not Maimonides? So it means over here you have a person with the outstanding mathematician, a person who's profoundly respected, and somehow the awareness that he was a person, a great philosopher, a person of a high influence. He was a person that even Einstein could appreciate the greatness of Maimonides. And of course, Maimonides, in a multifaceted personality, on the one hand, he wrote his famous work called The Guide for the Perplexed, in terms of relationship to God. And on the other hand, he also wrote a massive work, Mishneh Torah, the Second Torah, which basically cohesively created a structure, a codified structure of the entire Jewish law. And there are quite a few people in Lul Chabad, and it's been picked up by others, where they have a special...
We study every day, either one period...
One chapter or three chapters from Maimonides. Nice. And now, when you mention Maimonides, right away, it's like a Pavlovian condition reflex. Maimonides...
What was that word again?
Pavlov.
Pavlov.
You have a condition reflex. Basically, a person would think that... Maimonides, in his laws, he writes about idolatry. And in the laws of idolatry, he has, in his work, Mishneh Torah, he has many interpolations on different themes, free will, charity, etc. In fact, there's a very good anthology of Maimonides' writings, and Isaac Latursky of Harvard, and it's a book that everybody should get. Anyway, Maimonides, in the laws of idolatry, he starts out describing the spiritual path of Abraham. Abraham started out, he looked at the universe, he became aware, very sensitized to the fact that this universe has a creator. If there is a creator, then he has to be served, he has to be worshipped. And then he accepted upon himself this responsibility of going, imparting to others that we have to serve God. And how do we serve God? We serve God with acts of charity, acts of kindness, by a strong, intensive sense of personal ethic. And obviously, all of these things are just derivatives and extrapolations of the kind of work you're doing.
And the Rebbe was tell us, you were the first one that came out with the Tehei Shnas Tovshin Membeis, with the Rebbe. So tell us about your work.
There were other people.
But tell us about the Rebbe also promoted these seven laws
of
the Lubavitcher Rebbe.
In other words, basically, the Rebbe is interesting. The Rebbe is a multifaceted personality. If one would think about, well, how are you going to find Lubavitcher Rebbe? Lubavitcher Rebbe is a great religious thinker. He's over here on the shelf, we have a number of volumes. There must be hundreds of books on these shelves and outside. And these books were transcriptions of it, as lectures, as discourses, as biblical explanations. And at the same time, the Rebbe, so interestingly enough, one would think that the Rebbe would be basically concerned with an immediate Jewish community, and perhaps even a special Jewish community. Over here, the Rebbe articulated in a very forceful way the Noahide law, the responsibility for community, for humanity, and repeatedly would share this message with others. I have to, I would like to tell you, some people tell stories in order to make points. I make points in order to be able to tell stories. One of my favorite stories is, there was a policeman, a Gentile policeman, and a Jewish woman was driving. She was speeding. So he stopped her, he was going to give her a ticket. As she was taking out her keys and her wallet, he suddenly saw that she had a picture of the Rebbe in her wallet. So he asked her, oh, is that Rabbi Shnes? And she said, yes. How do you know? He said, oh, I used to be his escort guard when he would go to the cemetery to a father-in-law's graveside to pray. I would be among the police escort to protect him. And I didn't have any children. And my fellow policemen, my fellow officers told me, this person is a saint. Ask him for a blessing. So he's telling this woman, okay. He said, so I asked him for a blessing. And I had a child. And the child's name is policeman, a Gentile policeman, and this child's name is Menachem Mendel, which is the Rebbe's name. So over here we see the Rebbe, on the one hand, an incredible scholar, versed in Jewish mysticism, Jewish law, etc., but on the other hand, a person whose concern for a universal humanity is so great that it extends to reach every single person. And I tomorrow night, Saturday night is going to be the 24th day of Teves, and 24th day of Teves is the Yahrzeit of Rabbi Shneur Zalman Lodi, the founder, the creator, the founder of Chassidus, which we saw about Shem Tov. But then, two generations later, we had Rabbi Shneur Zalman Lodi, and he was also a very incredible genius, a very great scholar. Anyway, I used to write for Lubavitcher Women's Journal, that magazine, called Yiddish Ahem, and I once translated a letter from Rabbi Shneur Zalman Lodi, where he writes about it's from his book Tanya, he writes about the importance of giving charity. And in his there's a letter in that book. I teach it my class. I've taught that letter many times on the Tes Kislev, the day of liberation from jail. And the letter speaks about the importance of giving charity. And then he says in the letter, if a person is very much concerned with charity, that the person will receive kiflayim. So normally we'd say kefil, meaning double. So I translate it, and he will be rewarded doubly. The Rebbe had a famous pencil with a stubby point. And so the Rebbe crossed it out, and on top of the word double, he translated manifold, many times over, meaning kefil means twice, kiflayim many times over. So I think over here that the message of the Rebbe has been that when a person is concerned with ethical conduct, benefiting mankind, being concerned with others, so God will reward him not merely doubly, but manifold. And I'd like to say, why is it that I responded to you? I have many obligations with marking test papers, etc. But I realize that in actuality, you are a shaliach of the Rebbe, and you are concerned for benefiting mankind, and the consequences of your actions are manifold in terms of the benefit that you are bringing to many people.
You want to? I thank you for that. But I want to. Maybe we should tell the story about the Alter Rebbe, about when Napoleon came to visit him in jail.
Most apparent, it was the king, the Tsar.
It was the Tsar. And he came to visit him, and he made a blessing.
Yeah.
For the kings.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, he was against Napoleon. He never actually saw him. He ran away from Napoleon.
Yes.
But he actually...
Because of...
He was running away from Napoleon. But the Tsar came to see him, and he made a blessing. And he said to him, how did you know that I was the king? And he asked him a few questions. But, you know, the point is that the Alter Rebbe, the founder of Chabad Chassidus, had a vision for the world in terms of that the world should be a didalei zbarach tachtonim, that the world should actually be a vessel for God. This is a way to bring
the boat. Just elaborating upon what you're saying is that actually God is the King of Kings, Malach Malchem Lachem. So according to one, when the story has been retold, and one version of the story is that he asked, he said, because when the king entered, he felt within himself a certain kind of an inner feeling, an evocation that he's in the presence of majesty, and with this intuitive sense, he therefore, so in other words, that in paying respect to the king, it was that the king is what? Right. The king is an emissary of the majesty of God. So what he was doing at the same time, he was conveying to the king that as king, that he has this very significant responsibility. Apropos of the story that you're mentioning, there's another one that's almost inseparably connected with your story. The Alter Rebbe there were false charges brought against him, he was imprisoned. And one of the noblemen heard that there's a great scholar in prison. And this nobleman, he was a Gentile nobleman, but he heard that there's a scholar, and he learned Bible, and he had a problem, a textual problem. So he asked that if he could see Rabbi Shneur Zalman Lodi in prison to clarify this textual problem. He came in, and...
The scriptural problem.
Okay, anyway, and the problem that he had is that God, when after
Cain killed...
So God comes... And he's looking.
Cain killed Abel.
Yeah, and he says, Ayeka.
Ayeka, where are you?
Where are you? So the king asks an obvious question. God is omniscient. God knows all things. Why does he ask, where are you, if God knows all things? So then the Rebbe answered to him, a person can live for a certain amount. And then the Rebbe said a certain number. And that number was the exact number of the age of that nobleman. And to each person...
What did he say? He finished the story.
He said to him, a person who lived a certain number of years, and to each person, at whatever point he was in his life, God comes and he says, I gave you potentiality.
I gave you years.
Creativity. I gave you life. I gave you intelligence. Are you using your potentiality, your creativity, in a positive way, or you're not fulfilling the divine obligation that I have designated for you? So, and the story is, interestingly enough, when I saw it in the secondary stores, so it said over there that the nobleman said, Bravo. And I thought maybe somebody just added on, and I went back, I looked up the original source, and it said over there, Bravo. So I think, I want the Rabbi Cohen, yeah. I think we could say also to you, Bravo. For the wonderful work that you are doing.
So, okay, so we're going to leave now, we'll wind up with the last story of the Rambam, and the Rebbe once compared the Rambam's working and the Alter Rebbe, that they both worked in Pnimis HaTorah, the inner workings of the Torah, codified, wrote great works, the Tanya and the Shulchan Aruch, which the Alter Rebbe wrote, the famous Tanya, which is a Torah Shebichtav, and the Shulchan Aruch, he codified the code of Jewish law. And the Rambam also wrote two great texts, which is the Moreh Nevuchim, like you mentioned, which is a book
of philosophical work.
And then the code, the
Mishnah Torah.
Mishnah Torah. And he compared the two great scholars on Chavdal Tevis many years ago. Would you like to share with our audience any personal stories with the Rebbe?
Well, actually, I see them all very united with the Rebbe. So I want to tell you a story. I want to tell you a story about a chassid.
Right.
But basically, whatever chassidim do, it's a derivative from the Rebbe, and it's a manifestation of Lubavitcher courage and heroism. And there was a Jew in Russia, and he. And what happened is he was very much involved I'll try to get his name, but anyway, he was in Russia, and he was very heroic, and he would be the intermediary. His name was Getcher.
Getcher.
He was Getcher, and he would take the money, and he would subsidize and help people to fulfill all their religious needs. It was obviously the KGB was taking such people and arresting them, so it was very heroic. Anyway, so he wanted, I was there with somebody by the name of Menachem Mendel Sassenkin. And he wanted us to come visit him on Shabbos and we were in Moscow.
Right.
So, come visit my mom on Shabbos. Right. We could come by train Friday afternoon, but on Shabbos we wouldn't be able to go back there.
Right.
So in fact, when we were through with the visit, we had to walk back in the streets of Moscow back to the...
In the middle of the winter.
Sub-zero, very... We were sub-zero weather, except that we were very lucky. The wind chill factor was merciful.
It was only minus 50 and then said minus 100.
Anyway, so get your... quoted a verse in the Psalms. It says, "Mashlech karcho kafitim lefnei karasim beyamar." So that God takes his ice and he makes that there should be clusters of ice that are together, and then lefnei karasim beyamar. So the simple interpretation would mean it's so lefnei karasim. Who can stand? Who can endure when there's such cold? That because the cold is so penetrating. So he gave his own original interpretation. He wanted us to come to him. Lifnei karasim miyamur. Don't let that the coldness shall hold you back from doing whatever you have to do, assuming your responsibilities, being activist. So that's basically, that's the message to all the people who are watching this program. Sometimes we're very passive, we're apathetic. Lifnei karasim miyamur. Don't let the coldness and the apathy and the passivity and the lack of sensitivity hold you back. On the contrary, realize that you have that responsibility. Many times speaks about lasos lavir v'tachton, to make an abode for God in this world by means of Torah and deeds of action and goodness. And so, and as I said a few moments ago, that the Rebbe said it was horrible in Shalom with Bethlehem, that the consequences of all your work is manifold. And to go on, and definitely God will bless you in many ways that you cannot even possibly anticipate.
Amen. Thank you for your kind words and your blessings and your words of inspiration. And this is obviously a prelude to Mashiach, which we're all waiting for any day now, that we're waiting any day that Mashiach should come.
And this Saturday, and being the Yahrzeit of the Alter Rebbe, so we want, obviously, we say we can call many things. We should want, Ein Ol Mubado Mash, nothing exists around
the Mashiach. And we should see, take it from Yad, the Gula Mitzvah Shema, which this is part of the way to bring him in Mashiach, to make the world an abode, a dwelling place, and to bring godliness and goodness into the world. I want to thank you, Rabbi Metzger, for your kind time.
Thank you for the privilege.
And may we see Mashiach now.
Yeah, you surpass Wall Street. You're a winner, and everything you do will have many dividends. You'll never be at a loss. You will always be benefiting and
Hashem pays back in confines to the Shia. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
To do acts of loving kindness, something we like to call mitzvahs. Let me guess, mitzvah tank, God's army, sensing a theme.
Hey, Mendy, it's Noah. I'm here. Where are you?
Hey.
Wow.
How's it going? Good to see you.
Good to see you, too.
Yeah, you know, I didn't think you'd come.
Well, I kind of lost my job, so I had spare time on my hands.
I'm telling you, Hashkacha Pratis.
Hashkacha Pratis.
Yeah. So you ready to see my neighborhood?
Yeah.
All right, let's check it out. Dietary restrictions that we Jews have that were given to us in the Torah. So things like
So then why are those guys outside asking everyone if they're Jewish?
We want every person to do his or her part to improve the world. So that doesn't mean that everybody does the same thing. Each person plays a specific role. It's like what's it called? Division of labor, yeah? So each group of people, Jews and non-Jews, we each have a different responsibility. We all have mitzvahs to do, only Jews have different mitzvahs. Like, you see this guy back here who's lighting those candles?
What exactly is going on there?
Well, he's lighting a menorah. So it's a mitzvah that Jews do for Hanukkah, one of our holidays. So we light candles to commemorate the miracle of how the oil for the menorah back then lasted 8 days, when really there was only enough to last one. When we ask people if they're Jewish or not, we're just trying to find out which mitzvahs to help them with. It's like if you were to enter the military, they would place you in a specific unit with specific tasks, yeah? This is the inside of 770. This is the heart of Crown Heights. So this is where everything happens. This is the Rebbe's shul. So you see, guys are learning throughout. It's a school. This is where I learned. So guys are learning the ancient Jewish texts. Thank God. This is my friend Noah. He's visiting Crown Heights today.
Hey, going? How are you?
Sweet. I've never met a rabbi.
So we're all in God's army. We each have a different specific mission with some different things to do. But overall, we're fighting the same fight.
Dude, here we go. We're going to put him on and make him a class A man. Never been a man like you before.
So I'm half a block inside of where we were before.
Hey, look, there's another one.
Yeah, there's another mitzvah tank. Yeah, this one's a big one.
Thanks again, Mendy. Today was awesome. And I am surprised at how much I've learned from you. And I can't believe that you're my age. You're going to make a great rabbi someday.
Yeah, well, with God's help, we'll see how it goes. I hope so. But you know what? You can tell me you learned a lot, but talk is cheap. The Rebbe always says, Hamaisa hua ikar, which means that actions speak louder than words, basically. So you can tell me you learned a lot, but until you show me, right. Well, I mean, you don't have to show me, but
all
show
right.
It in general.
All right.
Okay, fine, yeah.
But thanks again, man, really. And you have my number now, so whenever you're in my neighborhood, you should give me a call.
All right, we can hang out again, you know, just take care. I'll give you the traditional Hasidic farewell.
All right.
Ki v'simcha seitzeyu uveshalai shuvalon heharim v'yagoy sisuchol v'chemina v'chol atzei asadei yichalcha Ki v'simcha seitzeyu uveshalai shuvalon
Mazel tov!
Take care.
Inyon l'parnosu v'kalitzi b'zeh v'zot kimidu v'kama pomim d'adini shulchanoru Askol masecho l'shem shomayim Yiyu l'shem shomayim V'chol drachecho do'ehu Is ne'madgish Adosi drachecho Dosi zayni drachim Udosi masecho Zayni masim inyoni rishuz Afoz dafer zeynutzen Af l'shem shomayim